Once again, very good evening to all of you. And I am going to speak. Already, Professor Bagchi has explained that though appears to be a combination of the old and new, but it's a very topical subject in today's geodynamics. In the same time, a global debate concerning the long-term strength of the continental lithosphere called relook to the continental geological models, and the inferences are drawn through the isostatic models, which provide information how continent are loads on the continent seen as a topography are supported over the long time scale. So there are large topography, and incidentally we have a very good possibility of doing the experiment of such kind in Himalayan region, from where isostasy in fact originated. So before I go to the main specific issue, I will be briefly talking on the background of the problem. But before that, I thought that it would be appropriate to orient, though most of us know, how the internal structure of the Earth look like. We all know that we have the crust, and below that mantle and the core, the three division of the Earth based on the composition. But there are other ways of dividing the Earth in the different sectors, and they are dependent on sometimes the chemical properties and sometimes like the strength or rigidity of the Earth, where we say the upper part of the Earth, which is strong, comparatively cool, called lithosphere, lying over the weak, hard underlying asthenosphere. And this is very important, which has led to the development of the plate tectonics and also drive the present day plate tectonics. We also know about the how the Earth behaves, or outermost, particularly the layer of the Earth behaves in response to the different time scale load. For example, if we see, we can see that the long-term geological loads are primarily respond to the model where we say elastic plate model on inviscid fluid. So these are the some of the basic backgrounds based on which we have been working on in deriving the internal properties of the Earth. So as I said, that we are talking of how the outer layer of the Earth behaves in long-term geological load. The starts of that is taking the isostatic models, and these models are based on the observation which originated around 250 years back, based on the observation of the anomalous deflection of the plumb line. You all may be aware that when the measurements were made, it was found that only 1/3 of the deflection which could have had if we take the Himalayan mass together. And that led to the birth of isostasy. And there were two models which were proposed, and one of them was called Eddy model, in which the crust gets thickened and the load is compensated with the buoyancy of the crust. You can see here. Another is the Pratt model, in which the topographic load or any other loads are compensated by the buoyancy forces that are produced by the lateral variation of the density above an equilibrium lithospheric level. So how do we test these models? So in early stage, there have not been much observations, but over the period of time, the geophysical technology had allowed to make observations over the sea as well as over the continent as well. And what we found that if we see the kind of the AD model, there is a root. Each topography has a root. And similarly, it has also been noted over the mid-oceanic ridges that there is hard magma which support the height of the ridge. Similarly, there had been very new experiments which allowed to more precisely map the architect of the crust and lithosphere, that is seismic wave propagating inside the earth, which has given the information about the thickness of the crust. And it has been found that at many places, the layer, which is we call as a crust, outer layer of the earth, are not so much downward as expected from the load. And that led to the another development saying that lithosphere is flexed like an elastic plate, and we can derive the property or the modulus of the rigidity of that plate based on the measurements on the earth surface and the flexure of that. And this model is called generally as flexure model, and the value which generally represents is the flexural rigidity, which is the matter of the thickness of the lithosphere, which in general called often effective elastic thickness, which is part of the lithosphere which behaves elastically over geological time period. And to estimate that thickness of the part of the lithosphere, it has been seen that if we use the Earth's gravity measurements on the surface of the Earth or the sea, we will be able to get those numbers based on the correlation between Earth's gravity field and also deriving a linear response function, which is called admittance. And if we compare with the observed model with the different schematic diagrams and then compare them with the computed models. So what it has been seen, for example, the coherence between gravity and Bugha anomaly and topography, if there is a very strong lithosphere, it will not bend either by the surface topography or by the subsurface load, but it will have the gravity anomaly, and therefore the topography and gravity anomaly will not be correlated, and the end member of the this would be weak plate where the crust flexing root and topography both will be related. So actual case will lie in between, and that's how the correlation between these with the wavelength has become a deterministic property to know about the lithosphere. The other option is doing the direct the plate flexure modeling and comparing with the gravity anomaly, and they all have been used for marine data as well as for the data over the continent. The measurements over the ocean had allowed to know that how the effective elastic thickness or the part of the lithosphere which behaves elastically compares with the physical models, where we can see that the thermal cooling model, in which we can say that as lithosphere gets older, it gets stronger due to the thermal cooling, and integrated strength should also increase. And what we find, we can very clearly see that the effective elastic thickness estimated across the globe over the oceanic region lie between the 450 to 600 degree centigrade. And the rheological property, if we see, they can be similar to what one can get from the estimates from either of three methods of determining effective elastic thicknesses. So this has always been very useful and has been done across the globe, and we also did over the Indian Oceanic region, And what we find that the over the time as the topography is in place, we can see that they lie between 450 degrees. So they can also be used for estimating how much the volcanic eruption could be when it is being put at the different edge of the oceanic lithosphere. And therefore, we have the estimates as well as the physical model. So inferences what we found from the oceanic studies that the oceanic lithosphere derived from the different methods, they match with the physics-based models where we have the thermal isotherms in the range of 450 degrees centigrade to 600 degrees centigrade, and also agree pretty well with the rheological models of elastic deformations. And there has not been any issue while explaining the estimates derived from the geophysical observations and physics-based models. However, when we come to the continent, the same method has been applied, and the estimates have been found from the different parts of the globe as much as in the range of few tens of kilometers. So what do we see that when we use these methods in 1997, Dan McKenzie and colleague have come with a proposal that whatever the estimates derived over the continental regions are overestimated, and they do not represent the actual value of the effective strength of the lithosphere. And many of you may be aware that Dan McKenzie also happened to be the fellow of Indian Academy of Honorary Fellow of Indian Academy of Sciences. And what this figure shows, the comparison between the strength of the lithosphere derived from the gravity observations and the seismic layers in which the earthquakes are found. And what they have proposed that the majority of the earthquakes lie in the lithosphere. Therefore, the kind of model which over the decades have been believed for the continental geology, in which the upper crust and the upper mantle contributes the strength of the lithosphere, rather the lower crust is weak, is not correct. And they propose that model should be something like the entire thing lies in the crust itself. And this led to a big debate globally. With this, we thought that we will have an experiment. We started just after this debate, initiation of the debate. In order to focus this debate, we took the two major issues which had been raised. The methods of estimating EET, which Dan McKenzie and the associates have said that they overestimate. And also the second thing, that what are the models of the strength of the continental lithospheres, whether we are talking of the model which is called jelly sandwich model or creamy brulee model, where the lithospheric strength lies only in the upper part of the lithosphere, which is crust, and mantle does not contribute to the strength of the lithosphere. It has a lot of implications. For example, if you choose two models and set up a numerical simulation for the continental subduction or continental collision, you will see that a model which has the mantle strength would penetrate inside the overriding plate, whereas the creamy brulee model, which does not have the strength in the mantle, would not go further beyond. So these kind of models are very important to test, particularly in the region of the continental lithosphere like Himalaya collision belt, and this provided us opportunity to look into the Indian continental region. So we started with the first experiment in the Deccan Volcanic Province, which is the south central part of the India. And what we find that irrespective of the different methods, whatever we choose, the value is comparatively less, which is generally often believed and that is around in the order of 10 to 15 kilometers, which matches with the models what Dan McKenzie and group has proposed. However, there are many other parts where they do not, and that started with the development of the Great Tea Map of India, which we published along with the several other organizations together, and used them along with the topography, and found that effective elastic thickness, particularly in peninsular part, without Himalaya, is ranging in the 10 to 50 kilometers. And I will come to the kind of models afterwards. But what we are trying to say that irrespective of the different techniques, the value remains of this range. These models are further extended in the Himalayan region with our few measurements from the central Himalaya, from the western Himalaya, and from the Himalaya in the Sikkim part. And what do we find? Two very interesting things, that though we can also define that how the lithospheric strength lies, parallelly, we can also see that it is varying across the Himalayan region. It decreases as we go towards the Himalayan, and that is the lead of the Indian plate. So these are derived from the flexural model. These are the coherent admittance model, and a similar model done by the other group had also substituted the kind of the observation what we had. But we needed to have a model which cut across the entire region and then finishes addressing the two different kinds of the of propositions made by the McKenzie and group and the other group are which is earlier believed. So furthering that, we have very recently taken the another kind of the model in which we can have the layered lithosphere, and we can use a model jointly topography, gravity anomaly, and seismological data all together from our measurements and different layers together. And what do we see from these models? That for place like Himalaya, we have almost the 84% of the topography is supported by the upper crust, but still substantial part, 16%, is supported by the upper mantle. And the effective elastic thickness, though, still remains 41, which is within the crust. And therefore, in other sense, we find that second proposition, which is widely believed globally, is found more in the northwest Himalaya. And similarly, as we go from west to central and east Himalaya, they vary. To summarize, what do we find? That there is evidence that the upper crust and upper mantle supports the topography. And most important thing which we contribute from the study in Indian region, that these two models, proposed models, compete to each other depending on the thermal and the compositional structure of that region. So there we can't say that one model is better than the other. But what is the need of doing all that? Why do we need to know it? And the ultimate thing is, once we have the lateral and temporal variation of the strength of the lithosphere, we'll be able to make a simulation of the stresses spatially. And here is one example which we have recently done, where we could predict the principal stress in the all over the Indian plate. With this, I thank all of you and welcome if there is any query.
Yeah, there is a question from Professor Rene Burgess. Is there a limit to the height of mountains on the earth? What is the reason for this limit?
Yes, we know that for long-term geological time scale, the topography can be only supported with the strength what they have. After that, there will be a collapse. So you might see the Cordella, particularly over the Andes and even in Tibet, very flat surface. So one can derive, based on the strength, what will be the highest mountain range be existing over the geological time period.
Thank you. There is another question from Professor Bhaskaran. Is there a role of body of the ocean water in controlling the dynamical behavior of lithosphere, directly or indirectly?
Yes, it had water had very important role when we derived the strength of the lithosphere. And recent experiments, particularly in the subduction zones, have shown that the terrestrial water in the ocean is drawn as deep as the mantle lithosphere, and putting them the olivine, the kind of mineral get becomes the serpentinine and changes the lithospheric strength of the material, and that's how the even terrestrial water plays a very important role when it seeps down in the earth crust and the mantle.
All right. Thank you very much, Professor Tiwari.